So I'm very happy to introduce our keynote speaker. You may all remember that in the last year we had a little trademark issue. Our speaker today was an immense help with that issue, helped us, you know, win that, helped us with all the legal issues, did this all pro bono, and since that time has actually been continuing to help us to solidify our trademark policies so that we can continue to defend GNOME legally. So please welcome Pamela Chestek.
Thank you all so much. Can you hear me okay?
Yes.
Thank you so much for inviting me to come speak on this topic. It's great fun to be here, and it's great fun to meet a lot of people that I only chatted with and knew through email. That's the way we transacted all the business. So it's just such a pleasure to be here and to be in a beautiful country too, which I've never visited. So just a little bit about myself. I am a trademark and copyright lawyer, U.S. trained, obviously. I have worked in law firms, and then after I worked in law firms for some years, I also was a corporate lawyer working at various companies. I was a lawyer, trademark lawyer for Reebok, who was then acquired by Adidas. Then I moved over to software, and I worked at a proprietary software company, and ultimately landed at Red Hat, which was my first real interaction with free software. I was familiar with the licenses and sort of thought I knew what was going on with them, but as all of you know, there's a huge gap between what the words on the page say and the community that surrounds all of that. And I'll tell you, it's kind of hard to, as lawyers, we're taught to be very protectionist and very maximalist and very conservative. And so when you start to work in free software, it requires such a change of attitude. It took me a good year before I sort of was, you know, on board with it all. Happy to support the community. It's been a great experience for me. It has really stretched me as a lawyer to work in this community. And I am a believer in free and open source software. So with that said, we'll jump into the events. So you'll see the date here. May 22nd of 2014, I got an email from Karen Sandler. Pam, check it out. Groupon just launched a new product called GNOME. It's a tablet, and they're referring it to the platform. They're referring to the platform OS as GNOME or GNOME. They're even pronouncing it GNOME, and it's already in the market. Any interest in helping the GNOME Foundation out? So I took a look. And this is what I found. This is a capture of the website. You'll see GNOME in big letters on this device. What this really is, Groupon didn't market it this way, but what that actually is that's an iPad in a frame. Just like those of you who are familiar with Square, it's just a Square competitor. So all they really had was an application that ran on an iPad and was marketed as this device. Doing a little more investigation, I found some trademark applications with these various iterations. Now, that's not unusual when a company is trying to launch a product. They're not sure what sort of iteration they want to use, and they will file trademark applications for variations on them. Altogether, we had 10 U.S. trademark applications. So that's what I found after Karen sent me the email. So then, and of course, GNOME is a registered trademark in the United States for computer software. I think it's cut off, so I'm not sure it's cut off. But at any rate, this is a registered trademark. So never attribute to malice that which is adequately explained by stupidity. Why is Groupon adopting the same trademark as the GNOME Foundation, a registered trademark? So I wrote a letter on May 23rd. I wrote a letter the next day. I wrote a letter to Groupon, their trademark counsel. And it was a very lengthy letter explaining what the problem we had with this was. And this was, I just love this paragraph. I use this because it's one of the favorite things I ever wrote in my entire life. This paragraph. Which, if you just indulge me in reading it out loud, I will. For purposes of this letter, I'm willing to assume, despite the GNOME Foundation's trademark registration, ownership of the GNOME.org domain name and website, @Gnome Twitter handle, Facebook page, LinkedIn page, Wikipedia entry, extensive non-commercial and commercial distribution of product, and many, many years of existence, that your company was somehow unaware of the Gnome project. I was trying to give him an out, you know? I will remark that in my personal opinion, throughout this process, and even sort of what I saw at this moment in time, I have zero doubt that the Groupon Foundation was fully aware of this trademark registration, but decided to take the risk and adopt the same trademark anyway. So then, not only did we have the original four, then we discovered two more. So you saw that was what was on the device. I discovered these after I had sent a letter, which is not that unusual. What happens, again, is they fixed on their design, they filed trademark applications. My letter and their applications were crossed in the mail, so that these applications actually were filed a couple days before I sent the letter, but I was not aware of them at the time I sent the letter. So, and their position has always been that the correct pronunciation of their trademark is genome, and that's what they were trying to do with this, you know, this differentiation of the letter G. So their position was, oh no, nobody would confuse them because they're pronounced differently. How many of you have heard the foundation's trademark pronounced more than one way? Yeah, right? And how many of you have heard it pronounced genome? Yeah, I mean, so, and they did, they were also not correct as a matter of law. As a matter of law, if anything, what a court would assume is that you're going to pronounce it by the dictionary pronunciation, which in the United States anyway is gnome, the G is silent. So nobody pronounces it that way, neither of us pronounce it with the dictionary way, but nevertheless, that's the assumption. So the assumption is that they will be pronounced the same way, so, but that's what the Groupon thought that they would do. So at this point, a few days later, we're up to 16 trademark applications. So this was May 23rd was when I sent the letter. We exchanged a couple more letters. Their lawyer said, please don't send any more letters. And we engaged in telephone conversations, which is a very sort of much more productive, because what happens when you have letters is you're obliged to disclose them to your client, and sometimes attorney to attorney can have sort of more frank conversations. Of course, you're also trying to play each other at the same time, so there's a lot of gamesmanship going on, trying to figure out what's happening. So June and July we had some letter writing and then some conversations. Groupon never offered to change the trademark at any point in time. We had these original 10 applications which had successfully gotten through the trademark office and were at a stage called opposition. And this is the stage of opposition is where someone who believes they're going to be harmed by another's registration can oppose it, can basically engage in a quasi-judicial proceeding to say, no, they shouldn't be allowed to have the trademark. And so that said, the first 10 applications were getting to that point. And Gnome, at the suggestion of Karen Sandler, we talked about it and decided that going public with it to raise money was beneficial, not only that it would raise the money, $80,000 that we needed by December 3rd in order to do it, but also would be a show to Groupon that this was a significant trademark owner. I mean, this was a significant entity that owned this trademark, just to prove the point of we're not somebody that you can ignore, as you have heretofore ignored us. And also just sort of raise the goodwill and the visibility of Gnome. So the last sort of substantive conversation was at the very beginning of August. Couple back and forth, so no, Groupon's still talking about it, up in the air, we'll figure out what's happened. Halloween, October 31st, about 8:00 at night, if I recall correctly, I get a phone call from the Groupon's lawyer. And at all times, I'm dealing with Groupon's outside lawyer. I'm not dealing with anybody in Groupon, I'm dealing with their outside lawyer. And he tells me that that day, Groupon had filed a bunch of new trademark applications. They had, they didn't ask us, they didn't show them to us. They just said, oh, we filed some more trademark applications, and he described to me what he was filing, or what, you know, he sort of described to me verbally what they were filing, which sort of, you know, wasn't sure what was going on with it. It takes a couple days for it to become available on the public website. So a couple days later, I was able to go and look at the website, and this is what I saw. Yeah. So at this point, we now have 28 trademark applications that Groupon has filed with variations of GNOME. So then we have November 9th. I write to the board and say, sorry to say, I think it's time to raise some money. And Sri writes back, well then, off we go. a long period of time, but we really didn't have any choice at this point. So it was, oh, and I do want to say, one thing that I did mention to Groupon's lawyer was, I said, we have not gone public with it yet. But, and when I said, at one point I said, when we have to go public to raise money, you're not gonna like what happens. And he sort of poo-pooed it, but I just wanna say I told him so. So lesson number one here, so this is about the power of community. My talk is about the power of community. So while I provided legal advice, it was the GNOME community and the free software community as a whole, at large, who are the reason for the success of all of this. I was an observer and a legal advisor, but you guys made it happen. So on November 10th, 4:27 p.m. my time, was the first tweet. I think this was the first announcement. Help the GNOME Foundation defend the GNOME trademark against Groupon. I saw this about 11 o'clock at night as I was going to bed, and I was traveling the next day. And I thought, well, you know, this is great. Maybe in a week or so, something, you know, we'll get enough attention, and maybe I'll have to deal with Groupon. That linked to this call to this website and call to action by the GNOME Foundation. And it took off. I don't know how many of you are aware, but it just completely took off. So we had, this is the Facebook page where it was announced. Google Plus. I mean, people just went crazy over this, and more importantly, people started donating a lot of money. People started writing to Groupon, complaining to Groupon about what was going on, about what Groupon was doing. Freenode posted a blog post about it, but more importantly, Freenode sent out a broadcast message that said, GNOME Foundation's been forced to defend its trademark. This goes beyond just GNOME. This is about the Floss community showing the corporate world that our trademarks will be defended, not just by specific victims, but by all of us. So I think, I don't know if others have opinions on sort of what was the most effective. I don't know if, Sri, if you did sort of any study of the social media and what were the most effective means or broadcast, but I'm thinking this one was pretty big. Yeah. As a result of, we got to Reddit on it, and of course nobody's in Groupon's favor on any of this, really. We have Linux France announced it, so we have, certainly within the community, we have a lot of uptake. And then it starts to hit the news. This is all happening on November 11th. All of these news outlets are picking it up. /. It was also big in foreign languages all over the world. It was being picked up. There was also this Groupon investor. you'll see the date was November 11th. That, I will confess, that was complete accident. We had no idea. I'm not sure that we were upset once we found out, but no, we really had no idea that what was going on. But even this is from their deck, which is publicly available. And this is the page that they were, I mean, one of the questions for Investors Day was, what is going on with this tablet, with this GNOME tablet? And so you can see, here's this new trademark that they, you know, that they filed the application for that shows up on that day when they were talking to investors about what a fabulous product this genome thing was going to be. So it was a very busy day, November 11th. One of the sort of most negative things that happened was that Groupon, there, I don't know what time of day this showed up, this is also dated November 11th, Groupon, an engineering blog, posted this on it. And this is the important thing, this is the language that it says, we've been communicating with the GNOME Foundation for months to try to come to a mutually satisfactory resolution, including alternative branding options, and we're happy to continue those conversations. And if we can come up with a resolution, we'll be glad to look for another name. So that was early on November 11th. Now this is very problematic because it's entirely false. they had never offered to change the name. They had been silent for several months and adopted and filed applications for a new trademark without ever asking us whether what we thought about it, whether or not we thought it was still going to be confusing, whether it was going to be a problem. So this statement then got picked up by the press. And GNOME Foundation, it made GNOME Foundation, let me make the GNOME community look bad. Well, gosh, why didn't you just talk to them? Why didn't you just, you know, why they would have shut, you know, why did you pull the trigger on this when you were having these open discussions? When the reality was that was not true at all. There were no discussions. So this cast aspersions on the GNOME community's trustworthiness, which when you're a nonprofit, there's very little that's more harmful than that, is to indicate that someone is untrustworthy. So this is back to that original blog post. It was later updated at the bottom. You'll see it says, update after additional conversations with the open source community and the GNOME Foundation, we've decided to abandon our pending trademark applications with GNOME. We will choose a new name. So that same day, I received a phone call from the attorney, I think around 11:30 in the morning. So remember, it dropped the day before, 11:30 in the morning, as I'm traveling to this desperate attorney that's trying to get a hold of me, to tell me that that they were in the process of abandoning all 28 trademark applications that very next day. So less than 24 hours after the GNOME Foundation went public with it, Groupon completely capitulated. This was their announcement too. This was a tweet. This was, 3:26 p.m. is what it has on my timeline. We decided to abandon our pending trademark applications. And this is what 28 abandoned trademark applications looks like in that. So in terms of success, right, if we had filed an opposition, if we had filed that opposition December 3rd that we were preparing to do, if it goes fully through the full process, the quickest relief that we could have gotten was 21 months until we reached a final decision. So almost 2 years from the time we would have filed until a final decision. And that's only a piece of it. So all that we were doing was filing a trademark application to say this trademark shouldn't be registered. That does nothing to actually stop someone from using it. They can continue to use it, they just won't have a registration. So that's even only a little bit of the battle. But in less than, through a social media campaign, a highly orchestrated social media campaign, less than 24 hours later, we had complete success, both on getting the applications abandoned and on having Groupon change the name of its product. So then the benefit was that there was, at 11:30 in the morning, I had emails that said it reached the funding goal. Remember that $8,000 funding goal, that was reached about 11:30 in the morning. So not even 24 hours. And then ultimately, the final numbers, this is off of the GNOME page, 5,622 people contributed over $102,000. That is all contributed by people who were unhappy about the way that the GNOME trademark was being treated and how a proprietary company was basically trying to steamroll over this free and open source community and project. This was individuals speaking, saying, and to protect and defend the open source trademark, and doing a lot more successfully than I could have done in the same amount of time. So that's lesson number one. That's the power of the free software community. Just phenomenal. In thinking about it, I have thought long and hard. Not doing research on it, but just thought about it a lot. And I don't know anybody else. I don't know any other effort that was any other type of like this that was orchestrated. So there are occasionally sort of overreaching trademark owners, and there's a lot of outcry about it, and those trademark owners will sort of withdraw in the face of public scorn. But that's not, I haven't seen any case where it's orchestrated. The power, the ability of this community to pull together, to orchestrate a campaign, to go out with a campaign, to reach its audience, and to get results from reaching that audience that had such a successful outcome, I've never seen. I'm not aware of anybody else having done that. And think about it, because who's going to do that? I mean, you're not going to do that for Apple. You're not going to do that for these big companies. There are some brands that we feel a strong affiliation for, but they're corporate brands. They can defend themselves. This was the community coming together to work together to defend what was important to the community. So then this was a tweet later in the day. I like this tweet. Some people were offended by it. I liked it. It's an engineer saying, this was the original device. This is what that page looks like now. It's an unbranded device. It's just called the Merchant Tablet. Groupon was, whenever someone changes a trademark, you're always sort of wary of what are they going to do next, right? They already changed it once, thinking that it was going to be fine to put a period between the G and the M. So there's always concern. So I've been keeping an eye on it. They were going to tell us what their new name was. I've never been contacted and been told what that was, and there doesn't appear to be a new name on it. It's just called the Merchant Tablet. So lesson number two. This was more sort of my fun. A commercial company just doesn't know what to do with free software. It became really interesting for me because now I typically represent commercial companies, so I know how we do it. I know how we play the game. I know how we settle things. I know what typically happens. Well, I was representing a different kind of client against a commercial company, and they really just didn't get it at all. And one of the things that they just seemed to struggle a lot with was this concept that you can't control the message. So when I assume many of you have employers and you have obligations of confidentiality and you're not supposed to talk about things. I mean, when you work for a company, the company controls the message. You can't control the message of a community. It can't happen. And so to explain to them, so they typically, as many kinds of commercial transactions, when there's a settlement, the terms are confidential. Well, we're saying, I can't do it. We can't keep it confidential. And that was kind of very difficult, very much a struggle for them and very baffling for them. You remember that original blog post that was very difficult. They did not want to say that the matter had been settled. They didn't want to make any, they wanted things to die down and shut up. They just didn't even want anything said about it afterwards. And we were saying, look, you've damaged us with this this blog post, you need to fix that. If you don't fix that, we're going to have to go out and fix that. So the fact that they couldn't control the message was very difficult for them. The fact that we couldn't agree to any kind of confidentiality, as a matter of principle, not just a matter of there's 1,000 people or, you know, I don't know how many thousands of people who are going to learn information about this because it's public, but as a matter of principle, we are transparent. And so we don't keep information from the community at large. We share that information. So this made it really kind of difficult for them to wrap their head around and figure out how to resolve this, because it's just the typical tools that we normally use, traditionally, you know, a gag order, were not available to them. So really that statement in the blog post was the most difficult thing, and we went back and forth a long time and a lot of iterations on it. It took over a week, so that blog post was up there for a week. And they eventually said, while notified by the GNOME Foundation directors that they believed this was the case, that it was infringing, we were not able to come to an agreement and we're proceeding with the registration of our marks. We apologize for any distress this has caused GNOME Foundation and the open source community. So we thank you. But it took a long time to get there, but we did. We did, and I think that did restore the reputation that did go a long way towards helping with the wounded feelings that I certainly had about what they had said and how incorrect it was. They also said both parties have, this was a joint statement that are on both websites, Groupon has agreed to change its product name to resolve the concerns, work on a mutually acceptable solution. So that is on, again, that is a joint statement that both parties agreed to make. So now if you go to the Groupon page and look for GNOME's, this is what you'll find. You don't find any tablet solutions. And the third lesson, and I kind of alluded to it earlier, is GNOME is a very powerful brand. Even in the free and open source software community, I'm not sure how many projects could sort of engender the amount of support and passion that GNOME was able to gain in this activity. So, I mean, you saw everybody reached out, and everybody in the greater community felt it was hugely important to support GNOME. It's a project that's very established, it's very important, and everybody saw this as sort of the commercial world starting to attack the free software world, and GNOME was at the forefront of that, and GNOME, and everybody wanted GNOME to succeed, and everybody contributed in every way possible with that. We had huge support, and it's for this project, which is such an important project and has so much visibility and such a great established brand. So applaud yourselves for the great job that you did on this. So that's the end of the prepared remarks, and I have time. There's plenty of time for questions about anything that you'd like to ask. We have a microphone. Yeah.
Thank you for that talk. That was awesome. So what I was wondering about is you spoke about the need for secrecy that companies often and how we were not able to commit to that. We did keep the issue non-public for the longest time until we had to make it public. So I'm wondering, I mean, and I don't think that was a bad thing, I'm sure it was required. I'm just wondering what the thinking was behind that, how you decide when things should be public versus not.
So yes, you're right. And it was more a matter of, and there was, there actually was an agreement that for a period of time that all that the board members, which is currently the only people that we can commit to. In other words, I can't commit to that no person in this room is going to say something. I can only get commitment on the part of the, you know, certain people that I'm dealing with. So the board was willing to commit to not saying anything publicly until January. And the thinking on that was, this is a very delicate balance, because we didn't want, nobody wanted Groupon to suffer sort of long-term a negative business impact from this. And they were suffering negative business impact. And so there was a lot of discussion and thought about it, and the feeling was that just sort of dropping it and letting everything, let all the publicity die down, would cause the least harm. It was not much of a concession on the GNOME Foundation to the GNOME Board of Community to say, yeah, we won't go out talking, we won't go on the talking circuit with it. You know, the commitment was if anybody asked, then they would be pointed to the information on the website. And that was to protect, not to protect, but to assist Groupon in sort of trying to get back to business as normal. And GNOME too, because there was some, GNOME doesn't want this to sort of have this long life either, right? You know, you don't want it to be about a conflict, you want it to be about the software. So the feeling was if everybody kind of just zipped it, didn't incite, just pointed all inquiries to the public statements for a limited period of time, that was, so this was, we're talking November until January, that it would let everybody kind of get back to business as normal. So that concession was made. Or not, I don't want to say concession, I think it was in everybody's interest to do that.
Hi. I was a bit curious about how risky and how costly this could have become if Groupon had not withdrawn their trademark application and continued this project.
Yeah. There's risk inherent in any kind of adversarial litigation process. I always like to say, you know, my chances are 50-50, and then any odds I give you are, you know, within that 50%. It's always there's a lot of sort of dice rolling anyway, things develop. You know, Groupon was, as I said, I believe that Groupon made a calculated decision to adopt the same trademark thinking. You know, thinking that the two uses were far enough apart that it wasn't going to be a problem. Am I certain that we could win? I thought we had a very strong case, and I thought that we had the better case, for sure. It was not, you know, they had very, very good lawyers. They're very, very well funded. I'm glad it ended the way it did. But I mean, you're always glad when it ends that way. But it, they could have made it very, very expensive and very difficult. And on top of it, one thing that happens when you do litigation is it gets very drawn out. And so at the beginning, everybody's all, you know, gung-ho, ready to go, ready to fight. But you lose enthusiasm after about 6 months. And then it's just painful to do it after that. So it could have been ugly.
So should we consider filing for more trademarks on other things that are important to us, or do you think that just creates more burden for us to have to maintain them and fight them too?
I am a huge, one of my missions in advocacy and free software is to encourage projects to file as many trademark applications in as many countries as they can afford. Because, I mean, it made all the difference here that there was a single US trademark application. And the United States was probably the jurisdiction that was most favorable for this situation. So we were kind of lucky that Groupon was a US company too, and we, you know, our turf was going to be the United States. I believe very strongly in filing applications in at least Europe. I mean, the thing about free software is you tend to be all over the world. So, you know, it's cost prohibitive to do in a lot of countries, but I would choose, you know, I would do at least Europe and the United States. And as you say, which trademarks is also, you know, is also a good question. All a cost benefit analysis. But I, having worked now, you know, in free software for, you know, 7 or 8 years, I think that registration, I can think of no single better way to spend money if you're interested in protecting your trademark at all than to get registrations. Because, you know, the thing that happened here was there was no way that Groupon could say, oh gosh, we, you know, we didn't know, because they were, because we were on the US trademark register. Typically, just talk a little bit about what happens when you're launching a product, and this will happen at any company of any substantial size. Certainly Groupon fits that, is you do clearance work. So you come up with some names and you do clearance work to see whether or not that name is available. And so the first place you look is on the trademark registers around the world. Maybe even if it's, you know, your US company, just look in the US, it would have found this one. So that's one of the reasons. I don't think there's no doubt that Groupon was aware of this trademark, was because it was registered. But if there had not been a registered trademark, that would have been much easier for them to say, oh gosh, we were taken by surprise, we didn't know. But they really, you know, had we kind of push come to shove in this, they would not have been able to deny that they knew of the Keynote trademark before they chose to adopt the same trademark. So registration, hugely important in my view.
So I have a question.
Yeah.
What kind of legal precedent does the situation have? Does the larger legal community see, I guess, what kind of impact did it have on the larger legal community on attacking a free software and new trademarks?
Yeah, I mean, that's a good question, because it's sort of, there's, from a legal perspective, there was nothing unusual or different about this particular conflict. This was a very ordinary type of conflict. What made it different was the trademark being infringed, and the fact that it was owned by Free Software Foundation. I don't know. So there's a couple. I mean, there's kind of a couple lines of thought I have on this. When they did the clearance work, one of the things that you do when you do clearance is you are always kind of looking at the owner and saying, how likely is it that are they going to sue me? Sort of, you know, legal balance aside, what's the likelihood that they're going to be able to muster enough, you know, money and time and be able to sue me? And I don't doubt that they looked at the trademark registration, saw it was by a nonprofit, maybe did a little Googling and said, oh, it's this, you know, little niche thing going on over here. There's not going to be any, you know, there's no problem with that. So you have a legal department who probably wasn't as knowledgeable about free software as we all are, and not understanding sort of how embedded, how far the tentacles of free software reach. So on one hand, there was a sort of the fact that a nonprofit, what looked like sort of hobbyists, garnered so much support. I mean, that's huge. So, I don't know how much my sort of colleagues in the commercial world have realized this, but but this was not a case of, if anybody wasn't paying attention to free software and their trademarks before, they should be paying attention to them now, because the community will defend them. That's one aspect of it. Another point that I've heard, which you didn't mention, that I also kind of want to disabuse any thought on that, is that there's something different about enforcing trademarks for free software, open source software. That's not true. That's not true at all. There's the trademarks, again, you know, I'm a trademark lawyer. So, the trademarks is everything, is the only thing you have. You don't have copyright in the software. You can't stop other people's behavior by exerting any copyright interest, because that's, you know, antithetical to what you're trying to do. But the trademark is very meaningful. It is about your community, about the product. It stands for, it's a brand signifier. It indicates qualities. So there is some, I don't know if people believe that that trademarks shouldn't be enforced or aren't as enforceable in free software as they are in the rest of the world. That's simply not true. They're just as enforceable, and maybe, in my view, it's even more important to enforce them, because that is your only mechanism. So I don't know if that answered your question. Other?
Yeah, so I have a question. Given, for example, the blog post, which obviously included that live from Groupon, about they have been in contact with
question. So if I understand the question, was Groupon afraid of getting sued back for the statement? Probably not. They had bigger things to worry about than that. I will say that statement was on an engineering blog, and I don't know who wrote it, why it was written, who reviewed it, who saw it before it went live, and it's very possible that it was just an individual at Groupon who, you know, felt compelled to defend the position and wrote it, and it wasn't legally reviewed. And the reason I say that is because I'm not sure that the person who wrote it realized it wasn't true. So the person who wrote it, who's, you know, maybe working on the device at Groupon, you know, is only getting filtered information about what's going on about the name. So that person may not have realized that it wasn't an accurate statement.
I'm wondering if there's anything we can do to proactively protect ourselves against any situations like that in the future.
Well, so realizing resources are tight. registering is certainly the most important thing to do. There is a service called Watch Services, which where you it's a subscription offered by companies, and they watch the trademark registers and let you know if someone's trying to register a similar trademark. This came up, I think, through people's Google alerts, was how people at the Keynote project discovered it, which works too. But you know, we could have discovered it sooner had we had watches on. But those, you know, there's a cost involved in both, you know, having them done and then having someone to look at them and see if their expense, you know, see if there's something happening.
What's your view on projects that say haven't already copyrighted or have a trademark? What's their exposure to, say, other companies that might already own a trademark?
Do I understand the question is if you're going to start a new project, how do you, what do you do about a name, or?
If you already have an existing project, and
yeah,
you have a name, but you don't have a trademark.
Yeah, so under US law, you do have a trademark once you start using it. So it's unregistered, but you have a trademark. Which doesn't necessarily, it can happen. So what happens in this case is one will get larger, and then all of a sudden the pre-existing one, the senior one, will become aware of it, and that's when you enter a conflict. So you have, even though it's unregistered, there are some rights, and then it just becomes a question of who started first. In the United States, who started first and in what geographic territory you were in. So, you know, it's kind of, if you were junior and there's a similarity, it's time to find a new name. And that's why commercial companies, that's why, you know, do searches before they put the energy and effort into renaming, is to make sure that that's not happening. Now, in other countries, registration is least important in the United States. It's much more important in other countries. In some countries, we call it common law rights when you don't have a registered trademark. And some countries don't observe common law rights at all. You have to have a registration in order to have any right whatsoever. So that, in that case, it's whoever registered first is the one who gets to use the name. So again, another reason why registration should be on the list. Yeah.
So I have a question. GNOME is by no means a small free software entity, and it is an established project, and we were lucky to have done our homework years ago to actually registering the mark. What would you say to smaller projects? I'm taking the example of my own TV. In the very unlikely event that someone is stupid enough to try to call their project the TV. I mean, it's already difficult to figure out for Anglophones how to pronounce it. But I mean, if such a situation occurred and someone wanted to name their product, TV, I mean, I wouldn't imagine this particular project, the TV project, existing one, to have the resources to do any kind of defense or to muster that amount of energy to leverage the whole free software community to defend TV. So we would probably be unable to defend such a market.
Yeah. I mean, I hate to say it is a a money wins kind of situation that you know, like any kind of business, the less the one with deeper pockets is probably going to win because you just don't have the resources. Even if that's just true across the board in many ways. Is if you just don't have the financial wherewithal to fight the fight, you may be on the side of the side of right and the side of might, but if you don't have the money, that's the way it goes. So unfortunately, when I harp on registration, that's sort of preventative. The idea is it keeps someone else from adopting the same trademark, but it obviously would keep Groupon from doing that. But at some point you just so that's sort of preventative measure, but once that there is a conflict, then a lot of times it just comes down to who's better funded on it.
I realize that Norm is probably far from trademark erosion, but what would you suggest preventing that happening?
So by trademark erosion, the term that I would use is genericism, where it becomes the name of the product itself versus the name of becomes the product, the name for the category itself versus a specific brand. And so the classic examples we pull out are cellophane was a trademark and escalator was a trademark. But what happens is there's adoption in such a way that people don't realize that it has brand significance. How do you do it? I mean, a lot of people, there are a lot of rules out there. You always should make sure that you use it as an adjective before a noun. If we say Gnome desktop, we say Gnome technology, Gnome software. And that really is sort of the best technique to do that is to make sure that you yourself are always conveying the information that this is a brand and that it has a brand significance and you treat it as a brand. That's the best way. The most, from a legal perspective, when there are challenges, in the US at least, when there are challenges, when you succeed on that challenge is when the trademark owner themselves did not observe sort of the rules of the road and making sure that they were constantly conveying that this is a brand, not because everybody wants, we want Google to be, not Google, I don't want to use that as a bad example because they're a good example of how to handle it. But if they say, we want everybody, we want our brand to be on everybody's lips, we want it to be, what the market thinks of when they think of product, then that's sort of the death knell to your trademark, is because then all of a sudden everybody's going to be using it as the category name instead of the brand name. So that's kind of the best, police yourself really is probably the best way to prevent that from happening.
With apologies, Pamela, this is kind of maybe a response or a suggestion to Jeff, that if you are a smaller free software project, then the benefit of things like the Gnome Foundation and Conservancy is that you can rest assets such as trademarks with a group of people who can bring in the right experts and to proactively raise money and help you do things that you don't have the capacity to do yourself. So if you're in this room and you're working on a software project, free software project, and you want to have a trademark, then speak to the Foundation and you get to work with amazing people like Pamela.
Yeah, and that's a great suggestion. I do also work for the Free Software Conservancy. And you're absolutely right. Is they serve as a custodian for those kinds of assets and can help you. Other questions?
I have a question.
Yeah.
You may. mentioned registering trademarks in at least the US and Europe. I assume with the EU that it's kind of one thing.
Yeah.
I know that for copyright, there's kind of an international recognition with, I think, the Berne Convention. Is there anything similar for trademark? Is there any?
Now, trademarks are registered, they're territorial rights. So you have, and it keeps all of, it keeps trademark lawyers all over the world employed. Because when I represent a multinational company, then I have to, you know, then I have to register their trademarks all around the world. So the only ones, so there are a couple sort of multi-country registration systems, the community trademark being one, so that is a single registration that covers all of the European community, 28 countries, I think, if not. But other than that, there's one in Africa, that's about 7 countries in Africa, but pretty much other than that, it is country by country by country. I mean, there is something called an international registration, but that's basically an international application. It then, you can sort of apply at an NGO who then sort of sends it out to all the countries you've identified, but each country still will examine it and issue a registration or not under its own legal regime. So that's kind of a universal application system, but not worldwide coverage. It's coverage by what countries you identify that you want to register in. Anything else?
More questions?
Thank you. So I'm pretty sure there are a lot of other small projects such as the one that we made in, which are wondering what the next steps we can have and what it will mean for us financially. So if you want to go to, we talk to the corporation or the SPLC about potentially registering our trademark in the US and Europe.
So the cost of registering trademarks?
Yes, the cost and the roughly where we should start.
I'm sorry, say it again.
Where should we start?
Oh gosh. yeah, that's a good question. That's a good question. I would start. I guess I can't really answer it because it's a very complicated question. One of the reasons I like suggesting registration is because it forces people to think about who owns the trademark. That's not such an easy question to answer. Where there is an established entity, foundation, then it becomes easy. But if I'm an individual, do I own it? Who owns the trademark? That's a very complicated question. So it kind of requires a lot of thinking from the beginning before you even sort of get into the step of what do I file. So I think it's something that you need legal counsel on. I don't think it's, I'm a lawyer, so of course I say that. But, I don't have an answer for that, really. Sorry.
Okay. Before I let you get off stage, Jeff would like to say a few words.
So we do have lots of contributors in our community and of all sorts of backgrounds. And we are very lucky to have had someone talented as you to support us through all these months of pain, joy, and tears with the Groupon case. And so it's been a real privilege to have you with us. And in addition to all the countless people here who owe you beer, we have a little special gift for you. I'm told that it is artisanal, it is a bespoke, small batch. It's organic and infused with a +5 charm against zombies. And this rare magical item has been handcrafted by one of the elders of Gnome, a practitioner in the exquisite art of traditional woodworking. So Federico Mina Quintero crafted this for you.
We have it. It's not a laptop.
Thanks.